all our listeners, and welcome to the Anglican Voice, the program brought to you every Sunday by the Incorporated Trustees of the Anglican Church in the Diocese of Trinidad and Tobago. I am your host, Shamiso Makshine, and I will be with you for the next hour. Tonight, we're chatting about an upcoming event, Day of Renewal. And we are also highlighting the Holy Trinity Cathedral, our mother church, as Thursday, 25th May 2023, marks the 200th anniversary of its dedication. But before we proceed, let us welcome the Holy Spirit. Heavenly Father, all honor and glory belong to you. I give you thanks and praise for this day, for life, and for all your provision. I thank you for this radio ministry and for its impact. I invite you into this space and I give you full control. I place myself and our guests before you. Lead us, grant us wisdom, and give us the words to say. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. We would now have our first song. Come on. Celebrate Jesus, celebrate.
Celebrate Jesus, celebrate, yes. Celebrate Jesus, celebrate. Celebrate Jesus, celebrate. Celebrate Jesus, celebrate.
'Cause he's risen.
He is risen. He is risen.
Celebrate,
celebrate, Jesus, celebrate. He is risen.
always enjoy hearing that song. And I think it's a fitting introduction for our first topic, which is the Day of Renewal. And joining me this evening is Miss Patricia De Freitas. She is the event coordinator. Welcome, Ms. De Freitas. Welcome to the Anglican Voice.
Thank you kindly, Shamiso.
Is this your first time on the Anglican Voice?
No, it's not. Actually, I've been interviewed before by Dr. Pear.
Okay, wonderful. So, without delay, can you provide some history on the Day of Renewal? How did it come about? What was the genesis? Where did this idea come from? Because I'll be very honest, I am not too familiar with the Day of Renewal. So educate me, Ms. De Freitas.
I certainly will, Shamiso. The Renewal movement had its humble beginnings at the All Saints Anglican Church. It was like a mustard seed planted by the late Reverend Gloria Waldron, who was the leader of the All Saints Pro Group in the year 1993. It was her vision, drive, and management skills that started this movement on the grassy area between the church and the hall. A tent was erected and a stage built. It was also a good witness to passers-by to bring the gospel of Christ, the good news, outside the church building. They cast their tents there for the next 5 years. And because of the overwhelming response to that ministry, they were forced to relocate to the grandstand, Queen's Park, Savannah. And after that building was demolished to make way for the new building, we moved to the Bishop Anstey Trinity College East in the year 2004. And we have been there since.
Oh, great. So when will the event be held this year?
The event will be held on the Saturday, the 27th of May. And I must say, it's a week of activities. We begin on Monday, the 22nd, with mission services within the four regions of the diocese. And students encounter during the morning period. Mission services will be held at St. Michael and All Angels on Monday the 22nd, Holy Spirit Church in Pinal on the 23rd, Holy Savior Curep on the 24th, St. Patrick's in Tobago on the 25th. And then we culminate the week's activities on Saturday the 27th of May with the Renewal Day.
I think that it's really excellent that all regions are involved and that it's not just isolated to one region. I think that that is outstanding. So I commend the team for ensuring that the entire diocese is involved.
And the schools are not left out, because during the morning period, there will be students encounter, that is motivational talks at these schools. The Bishop Anstey High School in the Northwest region, the Holy Savior Anglican School, Primary School in the Northeast region, the St. Christopher's Anglican School, Primary School in the South, and the St. Patrick's Anglican Primary School in Tobago.
Why was it important for you all to involve the school? I mean, I can imagine in these times, we need to plant those seeds from very young.
Exactly, Shamisu. And we felt that the schools should not be left out because we are in the job of nurturing, molding minds, ensuring that they're fit for the kingdom. And so we felt it's a good opportunity to begin at the schools.
Great. And I commend the team for including the schools. So what you're welcome, Mr. Freitas. So what can we look forward to on that day? What are the activities? What time does it begin? Who is the preacher? And is there a theme?
Oh, yes. The activity begins at 8:30 a.m. That is the Saturday at the Bishop's and Trinity College. And pilgrims are treated, on that day, pilgrims are treated to a complimentary breakfast because they will be coming from far and wide. This is followed by morning prayer, lots of worship songs, 3 messages from the teacher preacher, 2 during the morning session, and 1 during the Holy Eucharist. Then there's a healing ministry where the clergy takes part. Pilgrims are prayed for and anointed. And the day ends in a fitting way with the Holy Eucharist. It's Shemiso, it's a day of worship, fellowship, thanksgiving, and impartation.
Go ahead, Mr. Freitas.
The preacher teacher this year will be the very Reverend Robert Key from England. Dean Key has retired as Her Late Majesty's Dean of Jersey in 2017 and became the Anglican lead in the Archbishop of Canterbury, Justin Welby's worldwide wave of prayer in the Thy Kingdom Come ministry. Dean Key spends most of his time developing this wave of prayer outside the United Kingdom. He is also an honorary associate priest in his local church. Preaching, teaching, and lecturing on evangelism. Dean Key has chosen for his theme this year, Living His Risen Life.
Okay, very nice. I'm not sure if that is a play on, you know, we young people say we live in our best life. Was that a play on that, Mr. Freitas? Do you know?
No, it's not. It's not.
Okay. So why?
It's just that it is a celebration, the renewal. It's a celebration of life. Indeed, every new day should be a celebration. It is a celebration of the new life in Christ, a renewal of our Christian faith and recommitment to the ideas and principles of Christian living. The Feast of Pentecost affords us the opportunity to do just that. As we reflect on the first Pentecost, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, and we recall infilling of the Holy Spirit at our baptism.
I like that. So once again, for our listeners, the theme is living his risen life. Yes. And the guest speaker is the very Reverend Robert Key. So
yes, that's right.
Is there a cost? I would assume that there is a cost attached to it. Can you inform our listeners what is the cost And can they still register?
Okay, there's a registration fee of $100. Registration, pre-registration at this time, and registration online have been closed, but there is always the same day registration. So persons who wish to exercise that option, I would advise them to get there very early in the morning so that they can register.
Okay, so what time would you suggest that they get there? Because I know you said the activities begin at, is it at 8?
Yeah, we begin at 8:30.
Okay.
And our pilgrims are usually there by 7:30 because, as I mentioned, they are coming from far and wide. And we provide them with breakfast, so they're there early so that they can be refreshed and relaxed before the celebration begins. So those persons who are going to use the same day registration, I would advise that they be there by 7:30.
Okay, excellent. So any closing remarks, Mr. Freitas, that any last parting information you want to leave with our listeners, so that if they were on the fence, if they were contemplating, should I attend Day of Renewal? What can you say to them that will confirm in their minds, yes, they need to be there?
I would say to them, most definitely, do not miss this opportunity. And Shimizu, for the past few years, well, excluding the COVID situation, we have been catering to the spiritual needs of 800 persons within that auditorium. However, we have scaled it down a bit because persons are still very skeptical about the COVID regulations and so forth. So I would advise persons to come and listen to three powerful messages. Come and be a part of this large growing movement. Come and be revived. Come and be renewed. Come and get new insight into the Word of God. And I always advise persons that wherever God is feeding his people, they should be there. So I am inviting those who have not yet registered. You still have the opportunity to do so, and you still have the opportunity to be a part of this awesome experience.
Thank you.
I know you have never been because you mentioned that you have never even heard about it.
I've heard of it. But I've heard of it, and I see it advertised every year. I know y'all would have been affected by COVID, but I don't know, for whatever reason, I have never actually had the opportunity to attend. So I would make every effort to be there on Saturday, the 27th of May. That's the day before Pentecost.
Yes, please do.
Yes, yes. And can you give that contact information once more, please? If persons would like to register, or they would like to get some more information.
Or same day registration, I can be contacted at 714-8125.
Great.
For further information. And registration forms are available in all of the churches. So if you can find one at your church, have it filled out, we will gladly accept you on the Saturday.
Yes. And if you're tuning into the Anglican Voice for the first time, or you've been listening regularly to this program, but you don't belong to any church, and your interest has been piqued, please reach out to Ms. De Freitas for additional information, we would love to have you. All persons are welcome. This is not just for Anglicans, right, Mr. Freitas?
That's right. We cater for, it's a sort of an evangelical move. We cater for everyone. And we have had every denomination you can think about coming in on that Saturday for a day of fellowship, Thanksgiving, discipleship, worship, you name it. It's done on that day. And Shamisa, let me just add that our theme is, as I mentioned, that living his risen life, but the three sub-themes are ransomed, healed, restored, forgiven. Secondly, grow into glory. Thirdly, kill the weeds, produce the fruit. And they're all from Paul's letter to the Colossians and will be very much renewal focused.
Powerful themes, very powerful. And so I implore all of you listening to make every effort to attend, and I will do the same. Thank you so very much, Mr. Freitas, for your time, for coming on the program and sharing this vital information with our listeners.
You're most welcome, Shamiso. It's a pleasure being here. And thank you for giving the Renewal Movement a voice.
You're welcome. You're welcome. And I wish the movement success upon success for all their future ventures.
Thank you kindly.
Thank you, Mr. Freitas. So you heard it here. That was the event coordinator, Ms. Patricia De Freitas. There's going to be a week of renewal starting Monday, the 22nd May, and it culminates on Saturday, the 27th May, 2023. All roads lead to Bishop Anstey High School. And we're celebrating the 200th anniversary of the dedication of the Holy Trinity Cathedral. And to commemorate the 200th anniversary of dedication, we are showcasing 14 paintings of the Holy Trinity Cathedral that are a mix of computer-generated art, abstract art, semi-abstract art, and realistic work. Now, these paintings will be reproduced in the form of a box set, and only 200 copies would be sold at the cost of $1,000, which is a steal of a deal. There will also be an art exhibition, and the art exhibition is titled Mama, because the Holy Trinity Cathedral is the Mother Church. And details on that art exhibition will be revealed soon. For those who are saying, I'm hearing you saying $1,000, I can't afford that. Huh? Well, we've got you. We have a more budget-friendly option. We will also have postcards featuring these paintings. So if you cannot afford the box set for $1,000, or if you miss out, because as I said, we're only going to have 200 box sets, and when they're gone, that's it. So if for whatever reason you were not able to grab your box set, you can purchase our postcards, which will also feature our 14 paintings. So there's something for everyone. Now, I have with me three of those artists joining me this evening. We have Miss Stephanie Pruda, Dr. Deborah Bartholomew, and Dr. Gerald Hines. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Anglican Voice.
Thank you for welcoming us this evening.
You're
Thank
welcome.
You for having us.
Thank you. Thank you for joining me. It's truly a pleasure to be in your company, because I have zero artistic skills whatsoever. So I really feel honored, and I think I am in a privileged position in that I have seen your paintings. Unfortunately, they have not been released to the public as yet. Don't worry, as I said, we would have our art exhibition, which will be free to everyone. Anyone is welcomed, and you would have the opportunity to appreciate all 14 paintings. And let me just say, I was completely blown away. There are three unique paintings, three unique takes on the Holy Trinity Cathedral. But I'm getting ahead of myself. I'm so excited. I want to ask each of the artists to share some information about themselves, so that when you have the opportunity, listeners, to go and check out these paintings, you could somewhat connect the artist to their creation. So I would start with you, Stephanie.
Okay, so as you know, my name is Stephanie Prudham, and I am 19 years old. So, and in terms of how long I've been painting, that would have been, if I had to give an age, about even, well, 3 years old, which sounds very wowing, but I have been drawing, coloring since very young. And I have a passion for visual art, so it has stayed with me for all these years, and I don't intend for it to leave me. And my interest in terms of subjects to paint or draw would be people, as well as flora, as in trees, flowers, and nature. So that is an introduction to me.
Wow, 19 years. I believe Mr. Patrick Roberts, who was the person coordinating this effort, would have indicated that you are our youngest painter.
Yes, I was invited to this by him, and I greatly appreciate the opportunity that he has allowed me to have by inviting me, and I feel very honored to be here and be also known as the youngest painter of this exhibition.
And if I'm not mistaken, you're also a past student of Bishop's.
Yes, I am a past student of Bishop Anse High School.
Okay, wonderful. And so your career path, are you a full-time painter?
Not as of yet, but I would like to go into that field as soon as I see a willing market or audience. Because as I said, I have the passion for it, and I really want to, I just love creating things, and not just creating, but creating it to see someone have a lasting memory, to see someone happy. Because for me, I know art is just, it's a luxury, but it also is in everything. Everything that is art. So I really believe that it's one of the most important things out there, and I would love to stay in that field.
It's so interesting that you would say that, Stephanie, because I'm a scientist, and I always felt like science and the arts didn't really go hand in hand. But here we have two doctors that would have created pieces as well. So I would like to invite Dr. Deborah Bartholomew to the conversation. Dr. Bartholomew, can you share some information about yourself, and how did you get involved in visual arts?
Well, I started drawing when I was 4 years old. My uncle was an architect, and I have family members who are really very much into art. But I am a self-taught painter. I didn't do well in painting. It was always something that I wanted to do to be able to express myself, but I didn't do it well enough at school. In art exam, I actually did pastel work and I did pencil work. But I started painting when my older son was born 6 months after he was born, and I gave away most of my paintings. So I have paintings all over. And then I started to do more with my art. When my son was at school, I lived in India for 3 years, and at that school, quite a few of the students were children of Bollywood actors, and so reading wasn't something that was a favorite pastime. Which we were trying to get kids into the library, and so I suggested that I paint a mural. So, and that mural is still there. I painted it in 2010, and that mural is still on the wall. And what I did was, when my son loved to read, so the premise of the painting is that he is reading, and as he's reading, he's imagining that he's at on his favorite place in the world, which is Maracas Beach. And as he's reading, all the stories that he's ever read are coming to life. So every single place that you can think and look, there is a character from a book. And so I started using my art. I didn't sell art at the time. When I came back from being evacuated from Libya, I let my art tell the story of what I felt when we left. So I've used art a great deal to show emotion, but also to teach, to educate, uplift. So art is very much tied to my soul.
Wow, that is so interesting. And I take it that you're still a practicing medical doctor.
So you do, yes, I am.
In addition to your main career. Yes?
Yes, I am. I actually, everybody knows me as the drawing doctor. So if I have to explain anything to my patients, I draw it out so that they can understand. So I always have a stack of paper and a pen nearby, or pencil nearby, to draw stuff. But I've used art also to help unlock creative writing with my son. He's autistic, and so he struggled to write, and we used art. And now my son not only passed that exam and all his exams at CAPE level using the art, but he's also now teaching it to other students as well. So art is very, very important. And our lives revolve around this.
Yeah, it's very powerful. And I would admit that I was ignorant to that fact, because I dabbled in it in high school. In secondary school, we did have art as a subject, but I wasn't any good. And I just said, well, you know, I'm science-based, and science persons don't usually do well with art. And I sort of disregarded it. But as you rightly said, it's a part of our lives. So thank you for bringing that point home, Dr. Bartholomew. And I know Dr. Hines, I understand that he is the youngest in terms of age. He would have started art much later in his years. So welcome again, Dr. Hines, to the Anglican Voice.
Thank you very much, Shamiso, and good night to yourself and the other ladies.
Yes, can you share some information about yourself? I'm sure persons want to know, well, what does she mean by late in terms of stage? So you can share your journey with our listening audience.
Yes, I am a proud 66-year-old. I am semi-retired. I'm a semi-retired anesthetist. Never did any art in school, apart from in QRC. It was first, second, third form. You had some exposure, but never really took to it. Never really did it in any serious way. Once I retired, I asked my sister to find an art class for me. And I sort of happened upon art, and I've been painting, doing acrylics for the past 3 years, basically. Patrick Roberts, who we all know as the curator, I would have known Patrick since first form. I don't want to give away Patrick's age too much, but I mean, we were in first form in 1969. So he saw some of my work and invited me to participate in this show.
Great. And so that brings me to the topic of discussion, really, the Holy Trinity Cathedral, what really connected the three of you together. The Holy Trinity Cathedral is a national landmark, and Thursday coming, which is the 25th of May, will mark 200 years of its dedication. And it's so filled with history, and it has impacted, that building has impacted so many persons, not just persons who served at the cathedral or who worship at the cathedral, but the environs, as well as students who would have attended Anglican schools in that area. So I want to know, do you have a personal connection with the Holy Trinity Cathedral? When you were approached by Patrick, did you have to do research? Or what was your history with the Holy Trinity Cathedral? And I would start with Stephanie.
Okay, so for me, when it comes to a connection to the Holy Trinity Cathedral, so I didn't know much about it before going to Bishop Anansi High School. And as you know, it's an Anglican-supported institution. So I was able to go to the building, the church, when we had carol service. And I would go there, you know, over time, over the years. And I just found the place very awe-inspiring, that's what I will say, because it's the type of architecture, design, and aesthetic that I like to see, as well as the fact that I can see that once I enter the building, that there's a lot of history that I would like to know. I enjoy, well, I have said earlier that I have passion for art, but I really enjoy history and knowing things, so science as well. And seeing that building there, knowing that it has history behind it, I just want to know. And in terms of having to create a piece on it, it took a bit of research for me, because I went there for, you know, carol service, but I was not entirely familiar with more of it. So I would look at more images and even go there myself to just take another look to help me with the process. So my connection there was really through the school that I attended, and I am grateful for having the opportunities to have what I did have.
Beautifully said, Stephanie. Dr. Bartholomew, what about you?
Well, I'm an ex-bishop student myself, so My connection with Trinity Cathedral started when I was 11 years old. I also attended Trinity. I went to Trinity Cathedral when one of our past vice principals died, Mrs. Bishop. So it has a serious connection to me, but also there's a thing that I love in seeing stained glass windows. I remember that was something that I remembered, you know, going into the cathedral and just being in awe every carol service, you know, just sitting and just being entranced by the ambience, by being entranced by just sitting there in the pew and just being wowed. So I when Patrick asked me, I was honored. I was blown away, and I was honored. And my I didn't need to do any research. I just wanted to connect with, but what I did was I went around looking. I took a few pictures and tried to find an angle, because I didn't just want to paint the cathedral. I wanted to find something, some niche or some whether it was just a piece of molding or a window or you know, a doorway, something that just captured me and took me back to that point. And that's what I found when I went to take pictures. And I think I did a and then I also tried to utilize a different, I used mixed media and did part sculpture. And it was the first time I've done something like that. And I really thoroughly enjoyed the process.
And hearing you speak, Dr. Bartholomew, I can tell that you, that the stained glass would have stood out to you, because as I said, I am privileged that I would have seen your creation. So I know that when you spoke, yes, that really did stand out to you. And again, I want to reiterate, each of these artists' creations are so beautiful, but they're all different, you know? So don't think that you're going to see 14 or 12 paintings of the cathedral. It's different. It's their interpretation of the cathedral, different angles. And again, some persons would have used abstract art, semi-abstract. And so I'm really encouraging our listeners to make yourselves available for our art exhibition. And you really want to have either the box set or the collection of postcards in your home. It's a keepsake, and you're keeping a piece of history with you. It's truly beautiful. So I just wanted to again encourage our listeners to listen out for when our art exhibition will be available. And let me give Dr. Hines an opportunity to share his experience on painting and his connection to the Holy Trinity Cathedral.
Right, Oshamiso. Well, my painting is in acrylics. It is my chosen medium. I have always had this connection to old buildings. And I remember, you know, my first attraction to painting, one of my first attractions was the sort of old houses of Belmont. And I said, one day I wish I could, you know, buy one of the paintings that I see artists doing and so on, not knowing that when I retired or semi-retired, that I too would be able to do same. So that's part of the story. The other is the connection to the cathedral. I have attended events at the cathedral in the past. You know, weddings, baptism. One of my godchildren was baptized there in the days of the then Right Reverend Roald Dougan, and I've been there a few times, and as the previous speakers have said, it is awe-inspiring, a fantastic bit of architecture. I probably wouldn't be able to tell you what the exact style is, but it is awe-inspiring. Lovely, absolutely lovely building, and it is vital that we preserve that bit of architecture. And anything that I can do, be it my painting being reproduced in any form or fashion, to help along in that effort, I think it is well worthwhile. So I too would encourage all to come to the show, the art show, the art exhibit, to see what is on offer. Like I say, my thing is realism. So the other, I'm excited to see what the other artists have produced.
Yes, breathtaking pieces. I'm so blown away, because I can't emphasize how you can tell that each artist put their everything into their painting. And it is really a privilege to be part of this piece of history. I mean, 200 years, and we pray that the cathedral will go on to serve for 200 more years. But I'm just so grateful that we can feature our local talent, our local artists, as well as give persons a sense of the cathedral, especially given the fact that the cathedral has been closed due to, you know, its need to be refurbished and restored. And so in that absence of being able to go in and explore, you can explore the cathedral through these paintings. So thank you so very much, Stephanie, Dr. Hines, Dr. Bartholomew, and to all the artists. We are truly grateful for your service, for agreeing to be part of this initiative, for answering the call. So thank you very much. Any closing remarks?
I would like to say thank you for this opportunity, as well as I enjoyed the process and the experience of creating these. And I hope the same was applies to every other artist. And thank you once again for this opportunity to showcase our work and appreciation towards the church.
Shami, so I'd like to encourage everyone, young, old, everyone, whether you think you have art talent or you don't, whether you think you might appreciate it or you don't, this is a fantastic bit of Trinidad and Tobago's ongoing architectural heritage, and we need to celebrate it, we need to appreciate it, and I think this show is integral to that.
I agree.
I don't know if I can add to I can as eloquently say, you know, but I endorse everything that both Stephanie and Dr. Hines said. What I'd like to add is that I never envisioned, not in my wildest dreams, that I would ever be a part of something like this. Even in my days being at Bishop Anstey, being a young, you know, naive, scared little artist, even when I was giving away paintings and didn't know the value of my own work. But everybody needs someone to believe in them. And this exhibition, each of us being part of this exhibition, is testimony to that. Patrons coming out to see the art is not just about coming to see, to view history. It's also about building community and building support. And something so important for young artists, old artists, artists who are struggling, artists who are in between, who don't know themselves, who are not sure whether they want to do art or whether they're gifted or talented or not. It's all about building community. And something that's really, really important, but also in ensuring, not just ensuring, but also helping people to realize that art, visual art, art on the whole is key to our lives being fruitful, joyful, uplifted, and it being tied with something as spiritual and giving as the rebuilding of a magnificent church. I think it's key in our community rebuilding since COVID, but also coming together as a nation as well. So I really encourage people to come out to support and to let's build that community once again.
Agreed. Thank you so much. Thank you, Stephanie Prudhomme. Thank you, Dr. Gerald Hines. And thank you, Dr. Deborah Bartholomew. I wish you all the best as you continue along this journey, may God continue to bless you all richly. Thank you.
Thank you, Shamiso.
Thank you. Thank you, Shamiso. And you're amazing, by the way, just saying.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. And so, again, we cannot say it enough. Come out and support our art exhibition. Mama, we're inviting all Mama's children to come back home, celebrate this milestone, 200 years. We want our children, the children that came out of Mama, that came out of the Holy Trinity Cathedral, to rally around her as we celebrate 200 years. And I want to remind Presons that the 200th anniversary secretariat is located at the Holy Trinity Cathedral and open to the public Monday to Friday from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. So you can visit to purchase your memorabilia items, your prayer beads, your snippets, t-shirts, magnets, etc., and your gala tickets. Have you gotten your gala tickets as yet? A touch of gold. We're going to be at the Hyatt Regency on June 2nd from 7 p.m. Contribution is only $600, and all proceeds go towards the restoration of the Holy Trinity Cathedral. So get your outfits ready. Make sure you have your gold something to add to your outfit, and you can pick up your tickets at the Holy Trinity Cathedral. Also remember that we will be at the Queen's Park Savannah on June 4th. Yes, June 4th is our anniversary service. It's Trinity Sunday, and we're going to be there from 9 a.m. There will be no service throughout the diocese, so we're inviting persons to come out in their numbers at the Queen's Park Savannah. We're going to have a special guest speaker all the way from the United Kingdom, so you don't want to miss that. Again, June 4th. All roads lead to the Queen's Park Savannah. So we've come to the end of another edition of the Anglican Voice. I want to thank all my guests, Mr. Freitas, Ms. Stephanie Prudhomme, Dr. Hines, and Dr. Bartholomew. So thankful for them giving of their time and joining me on the Anglican Voice. I invite Prisons, wherever you are, to close your eyes and bow your heads as we offer up a word of prayer to God. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this show. I thank you for our guests, and I pray that your people were edified in some way. I place the day of renewal in your hands, and I give thanks for the Holy Trinity Cathedral and its 200 plus years of service. I ask that you bless our artists that give generously of their time and talent. May they continue to grow in you and in their ministry. I also pray for the leadership of the Anglican Church in the Diocese of Trinidad and Tobago, our bishop, our dean, our archdeacons, and all other members of clergy. Cover them, Lord. Grant them wisdom and use them as we reimagine mission. We also thank you for our listeners, and I pray that your protection be upon them during this week. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Thanks for joining us. And remember, this Thursday, May 25th, is the actual anniversary of the Holy Trinity Cathedral. So we ask that you keep the Holy Trinity Cathedral in prayer in your various parishes. We ask that you have a day of fasting, that you do something to commemorate this milestone. Have a blessed week, everyone, and remember to be salt and light wherever you go. Take care and God bless.